existence of aliens is being kept hidden from the public. One man makes it his mission to discover the truth.
Bonkers. Mr. Bonkers. Bonkers.
A lot of people are doing nothing more than getting huge quantities of mass and see if they can get a gravity wave to cause things to move. Mm-hmm. Well, that isn't what we're talking about at all. Mm-hmm. So I wondered if gravity could be related to its cousin magnetism. Mm-hmm. And so I found that when I take two magnets together, I have some neodymiums around here that I'm actually afraid of. They can danger you. Mm. But anyhow, you take a magnet, you go to put them together and they go clunk, right? Mm. But you take one of them, move it around, and all of a sudden it doesn't want to go together.
Yeah, right, the repulsive.
So I got, I ordered one at $5,000 a piece. Wow. with a quarter inch hole through between both of them, and I put a brass bolt and I tighten them down, forcing them together. Mm-hmm. And then I put them together in a thing that looks kind of like a rock. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then I got another one that didn't have magnets in it. Mm-hmm. And Galileo, in all his endeavors, he went up to the Leaning Tower of Pisa. And he dropped a big rock and a small rock. Mm-hmm. And his buddy down at the bottom kept telling him that the large rock and a small rock arrived at the same time. Well, I went up to in the Lockheed Building 501. Mm-hmm. By the side of escalators and elevators.
Oh wow!
And I got nine guys that were not educated and didn't have pre opinions on anything. Mm-hmm. And I dropped my two rocks. Mm-hmm. And I said, "What I would like you to do is," I told them, "what I'd like you to do is I would like you to take whichever one arrives first. Get it in your hand, and when I come down the elevator, hand it to me." Mm-hmm. Now, they looked identical, except for...
So, and nobody knew it was inside?
No, absolutely not. Mm-hmm. All the nine times that I tested it, it's as though the one with the opposing magnet field extending out, mm-hmm, 3 feet on each side, I actually measured how big the field was. And on each side of one rock, I had a total of 6 feet. At any rate, the other rock arrived first.
Which one arrived first?
The one that had no magnetic field in it.
So you were able to cancel out gravity to a certain degree. Reduce the mass gravity effect.
Precisely.
By opposing fields.
Isn't that nice? You bet. And got nine signatures and wit. I always skip.
Did that at Lockheed? What year was this?
At least 8 years ago.
This is the actual document of Boyd's, where he proved that by altering the field in a falling body, the magnetic field, it reduced its mass gravity equivalent and canceled out the effects of gravity to a certain percentage. And he did a building 500 drop test conducted from a height of 59 feet. The location is in White Settlement, Texas, and the time was 12:20 p.m. And this was in 1995, December 12th. Nobody knows this.
I know it.
So gravity, mass gravity is not, you can alter it.
Gravity within itself has to have, gravity goes through anything that is solid and anything like iron or anything else. But it has to have a magnetic component, mm-hmm, which may be canceling out within itself. Mm. But as soon as it got around my rock, it all of a sudden recognized the presence of my rock.
One of Einstein's students tried to merge electromagnetism and gravity, and he rejected it.
But he didn't have an experiment like you
did. No, I understand. I know that.
But somebody, one of my science students tried to merge electromagnetism and gravity, and he rejected it. But he didn't have an experiment like you did.
No, I understand. I know that.
But somebody, one of my science students tried to merge electromagnetism and gravity, and he rejected it. But he didn't have an experiment like you did.
No, I understand. I know that.
But somebody, one of my science students tried to merge electromagnetism and gravity, and he rejected it. But he didn't have an experiment like you did.
No, I understand. I know that.
But see, nature never uses English. It doesn't speak. It doesn't speak any language. But yet it's talking to us all the time.
Right.
And the key thing is to identify what it's saying.
With the meager information that has been accumulated over a period of years, astronomers cannot draw too many definite conclusions about Mars. We realize there are probably certain unavoidable errors in our calculations, any one of which could make a big difference as to whether or not there is life as we know it on Mars.
For the past half century, the intriguing possibility of traveling to Mars in a spaceship has challenged the imagination of many men. Rocket ships of all sizes and shapes have been designed, but most of them rely on an enormous consumption of chemical fuel to escape the pull of the Earth's gravity. A spaceship using an electromagnetic drive to neutralize gravity is the obvious answer. But such a device is still a dream for the future.
How would you define gravity? Could you describe in layman's terms its basic principles for us?
Gravity is something difficult to explain because it's something that we essentially don't understand. It's just something that we can observe. Not much is really known about gravity. There are many theories about it, but they are just mainly theories. There's theories of gravitons, which allege that these subatomic particles that act like an attractive force like gravity that exchange between two pieces of matter. There is also a theory that gravity is a form of wave, an electromagnetic wave. But basically, gravity is a force. It's the inherent property of matter to have gravity, a mutual attraction for each other.
Deanne Divis with United Press International. Could you please address the vehicle that there was a drawing displayed of? Why would this vehicle be on display at an air show? What is the power source that you are asserting is going to be so very useful? And how can you determine that this vehicle is not something that is being developed, you know, by a government agency?
In fact, I think that was the testimony. This is an alien reproduction vehicle, and just to be clear, this means that it is based on advanced anti-gravity and zero-point energy propulsion systems. They are being manufactured by a consortium of companies that include Lockheed Martin, Northrop, SAIC, and other corporations. But this is not a jet internal combustion system at all. It is actually kicked in by a type of electric power source, and it then accesses this ambient zero-point energy field that is responsible for all matter and energy existing, and by special configurations and what have you, it causes a cancellation of mass inertia and an anti-gravity effect.
The white background represents the dark energy field. The pulsing represents the electromagnetic distortion around all matter, like two atoms. The electromagnetic distortion pushes dark energy away from matter on a gradient and makes all matter appear to have an attraction towards itself. Gravity can be defined as the electromagnetic force that matter exerts on the universe on dark energy that causes a dark energy field effect, or gravity. You can scale this up from atoms all the way to planets and suns and even black holes. Anything that creates gravity is actually not pulling things into itself like a gravity well. More, it is pushing dark energy away, and in doing so, dark energy is pushing harder on the side with the least distortion. As the fields touch each other, it creates a path of least resistance, and the two objects are forced together by the stronger dark energy field on the side with less distortion, giving matter an attraction towards itself. It's dark energy that causes an attraction of matter towards itself that creates gravity.
Modern science, current science, right now, identifies one gravity. It's one force in nature. Apparently, through research at S4 or information gained from one of the crafts they were researching there, it appears that there are two different forms of gravity. One form works on an atomic scale, on subatomic particles, holding pieces of matter, holding atoms themselves together. Another works on a
larger scale, the scale we're most familiar with, holding planets in orbit, holding ourselves to the ground, things of that sort. Because it produces a gravitational field, I wouldn't say the craft is invisible during the day. However, if you're under the craft, because of the way the gravity is being used, gravity bends time and space, and it bends light. If you are looking underneath the craft or from certain vantage points, you will actually see what's above the craft. It's really a trick of the way light bends under the influence of gravity. For instance, we can see stars that are behind the sun, that are blocked from our view by the sun. The reason we can see them is because the sun is a tremendous gravitational field and it's bending the light around it where we can see the star. Space-time and gravity are all essentially interrelated. They all act on one another. Gravity bends space. Gravity also distorts time. When you vary one, you essentially vary the other two. If you, as an example, if you have a massive body, say a planet or something that's making a lot of gravity, producing a lot of gravitational waves, if you will, it distorts space, it bends space to it. It also slows down time. These things aren't theories, we know them to be true.
They had an easel next to it with a drawing, a cutaway drawing, that that showed some of the internal components, how they were arranged with and oriented to one another. And then they had a little a TV monitor with a tape player below it that was showing this continuous loop of this thing sitting or hovering over a dry lake bed out in the desert somewhere, and as you would watch the tape, this thing would make went from a hovering position, made these three little sort of hops going to the side, and then as the camera followed it, it just went straight up and disappeared outside. It was down to nothing in just a matter of a second and a half or so. One of the things that this general had said during the presentation, one of the things that really stood out in Brad's mind was that he said that these vehicles were capable of light speed or better.
So according to his account, on November 12, 1988, Mark's friend inadvertently gained access to a highly classified air show where the featured hardware of the event was real flying saucers. They were really strange looking, but appeared functional and were named to suggest anti-gravity and reverse engineered alien technology. An official present stated they could travel faster than light. Despite their futuristic performance capabilities, these appeared to be stripped-down, road-worn working prototypes, which had seen practical operation for years. If this were the case, they were crude but tangible proof of concept for a staggering leap in aviation technology. They used extremely advanced electromagnetic or field propulsion, as opposed to solid or jet fuel, nuclear power, or any other commonly known conventional means. It also meant our government and at least one other major defense contractor, Lockheed Martin, had been developing and deploying functional systems along these lines for many years.
And he just sat down, and right where we were sitting there at his table, he just kind of sketched out with an ink pen on a piece of legal size white paper, and put some little handwritten call outs around the edges that described the number of capacitor plates in each one of the little sections, that there were they were so wide at the end, and the crew compartment was definitely about 12 feet in diameter. Just kind of put all these things down as close as he could remember to the way they existed.
This was called the Flux Liner.
This is probably the strangest one you've shown me yet. This actually flies?
It actually flies on the principles of high voltage electrical charges.
Alicia Davidson described being escorted into the engine room and seeing the propulsion system components. And it involved a central column that was made of a transparent glass-like material. She said there was a silvery fluid that was spiraling upward at the bottom of this column. Down in kind of this well that was in the center of the spacecraft was this little tiny flywheel-like mechanism spinning, which matched the ARV also. And this is at a point when this young lady had never seen any of the drawings that I'd done of what the ARV was structured like. I was just talking about propulsion components in general. But then she said that when you looked across this little well, this lower floor area in the center of the room. It was like a guardrail around it. She stood there. She said, you could look across, and she said it looked like that below the deck she was standing on was this glass-like material with these coils of wire going through it. And they were spaced out in the same proportions as the ones on the UOV. The thing that she said that was most significant was that the column itself was rotating in one direction, and the flywheel was opposite, spinning in the opposite direction. There was counter-rotation, which is something that's often been reported in UFO sightings. You see components on the craft that are spinning in opposite directions.
Which is basically Tesla's ideas they put together. This is kind of an anti-gravity thought. So I've made it, and I'm trying to figure out how this thing works. So this kind of freaks me out because I'm spinning, the inner ring is going to spin counterclockwise. The outer ring all of a sudden starts spinning clockwise. I don't know why this is happening. So let's go ahead and try this. They're spinning opposite ways right now. Take it down. I don't want to burn it out. But it makes no sense that the outer ring would be spinning the opposite way of the inner ring.
Back here on Earth, the scientific community has been busy since the end of the Industrial Revolution. There have been dozens, perhaps hundreds of US and international patents dealing directly with electrokinetics and electrogravitics, going back to the turn of the last century. It would be safe to assume private industry and the military have also been working on a great deal of related applications off the public record. In short, since Nikola Tesla's first experiments with pushing electricity around, mankind has had a thing for anti-gravity.
you know, I find it really remarkable that there's so much similarity between the two objects.
Mm-hmm. And when is that patent from?
May 30th, 1967. It's called a magnetohydrodynamic propulsion apparatus. And so I started thinking, well, maybe it's like a cyclotron. Maybe there's an electrical discharge from this. Basically, this whole thing looks like a giant Tesla coil. It's got the capacitor array. It's got, you know, a central column that looks like the secondary windings of a Tesla coil. And this might even go back to something that Nikola Tesla discovered back in the 1940s. And, you know, just was all hushed up. And all the UFO sightings we've ever seen were something that came from Nikola Tesla, not from another planet.
The ARV system, for all of its claims of flashy, out-of-this-world propulsion capabilities, was indeed remarkably simple. It could be described as a large-scale, souped-up Tesla coil, designed to negate gravity and inertia, with off-the-shelf navigation and life support systems bolted on, almost as an afterthought. You could think of it as the Model T of anti-gravity vehicles, an industrial dune buggy, or crude hot rod that can get you to Mars in a few minutes. In this version at least, first class seating was still a way off.
There's a large capacitor array. Through the middle of the crew compartment is a central column that's called the amplifier section that's in the middle of the craft. On the very center point of that column is what looks like a large 9-foot diameter flywheel type mechanism. Then around the belt line of the crew compartment is about a 2-foot wide coil of wire that's embedded in the same glass-like material that the capacitor section plates are embedded in. The ejection seats are mounted back-to-back. There's four of them in the smallest version of the craft, and they're mounted on this central column on a set of rails, a bowl that moves around and can be used to convey the commands of the pilot in terms of what he wants to do in terms of shaping the field around the vehicle. And right in the center of that bowl is a kind of laser diode.
This aircraft was using extremely high voltages, and the voltages would ionize the air around the vehicle so much that it would start producing X-ray photons, which are absolutely lethal. So you have to have basically a barrier to protect yourself. With a little air-driven claw that's on the end of it. In fact, I think that craft's magnetic field or electromagnetic field is probably so powerful that conventional little electric motors probably wouldn't work. The electrostatic field created by this huge capacitor array and the ionization that occurs just because of the propulsion system might be enough to create a level of ionization around the craft that's high enough that it would produce X-ray photons of its own accord. And so you would want to be able to protect the pilot and the crew members from that radiation. So anyway, that's the general overview of the structure of the vehicle. This is a vehicle that has the ability to travel up to or beyond the speed of light. And part of the reason that it's able to do that is because it exploits the energy form that's embedded in space-time that's responsible for the effects of mass and inertia.
So here we have a configuration of various components, creating a system that's somehow capable of producing and maintaining an insane amount of energy in a concentrated field around the vehicle. This field can be precisely controlled by the pilot with the aid of a basic throttle, an alien steering ball, and a bunch of casino cameras. There's plenty of onboard oxygen, handy if you're off the planet, and a lead coating so the occupants don't get fried in their seats, and a robot arm in case you need a robot arm somewhere. It looks like a big clumsy diving bell from 1905, but apparently works like a helicopter you can take past light speed. Its beauty and elegance lie in the propulsion system, maybe a really, really fast one that gets around currently accepted physics, one we commonly associate with UFOs.
For anybody who has followed the work of Einstein, or just basic physics, you know, one of the sort of inviolable rules of physics is that there's no material object that can actually go faster than the speed of light. So somehow or other, and I'm not saying we got this from aliens, but they did call it the alien reproduction vehicle, but somehow or other, this simple system that Brad described in these diagrams was able to do this.
In the middle of last century, physicists made an astounding discovery, and that is what we ordinarily consider empty space isn't empty at all. even if you go to the far reaches of outer space, it turns out that rather than emptiness, what we call the vacuum is really a seething cauldron of what we call quantum energy or zero point energy. Zero point just simply means that even if you froze the entire universe down to absolute zero, froze out all motion where everything would be as quiet as you could possibly get it, this energy is still there. It was predicted by the mathematics of quantum theory, but the numbers were so large. For example, there's enough energy in the volume of a coffee cup to evaporate the world's oceans. It was thought, well, this must be some kind of artifact in the theory. But as time went on, various predictions in quantum theory were verified in the laboratory, and it finally turned out we had to take these numbers seriously.
So in a sense, if you find the right way to do it, you can actually sort of reduce the mass of an object. And if you can do that, then of course it takes less propulsive force to push it around. It means that it can go a lot faster because it's not limited by the amount of mass that it increases to as it accelerates. In fact, it may in fact be a situation where the faster you go, the more energy you have available to continue the acceleration process, and at the same time, the mass is becoming relatively less and less and less. So it really enables the possibility of being able to go faster than speed of light without violating general relativity, and that was the most fascinating aspect of the whole thing.
By using the flux in the vacuum of space-time as a power source for your propulsion system. So literally, the faster you go, the more energy you have available that you convert into propulsive force, and the lower the relative mass of the vehicle becomes. So it's actually sort of an inversely proportional kind of a relationship.
Most scientists with an instant response would think on special relativity terms and say, well, the velocity of light is a limitation. You can't go faster than the speed of light. And therefore, to conceive of us exploring stars or other people coming here, it's too far. They just can't get from here to there. We might explore our own solar system, but that's probably as far as we're going to get. But the truth of the matter is that in general relativity, that's not the case. There are options there. That limitation now has begun to evaporate due to the new understandings and predictions coming out of general relativity. So that's not the issue.
There was obviously an electromagnetic field that was forming around this ring of wire that ran around the crew compartment, and that would form a kind of donut-shaped or toroid-shaped electromagnetic field with field lines stroking right through the middle of the craft, which happened to be where there was this large central column. Now, the central column was supposed to be the most secret part of the vehicle. Brad didn't seem to know too much about that, but he said that it used mercury in some form. He thought it might use it as a noble gas, vaporized mercury.
The mercury, based on a number of accounts, appears to circulate in a kind of a closed loop system that runs down through the cylinder in the middle and then back up in the space between the inner cylinder and the outer cylinder. And there's a counter rotation kind of a mechanism that's occurring there too. And at the midpoint is this thing that looks like a flywheel. But in effect, what I think its actual function is similar to what is called a homopolar generator, where you can use the centrifugal forces of a disk, a conducting metal disk that's spinning, to actually throw the electrons in the material out to the edge, where they can be literally tapped off with something that looks like a brush that has conductive bristles. Now, I believe that what happens is that this vehicle develops probably several million volts of voltage, and the sheer power of the electrostatic field that is created in this capacitor array actually has the ability to polarize the surrounding space-time, and it polarizes the so-called zero-point energy that is embedded in the space-time. So it creates kind of a positive and a negative aspect to the status of that zero point energy that's surrounding the vehicle.
So just to kind of give a little background, the idea of a space warp works on the principle of expanding and contracting space in such a way that allows you to go somewhere very, very quickly.
What this does is it leads to something that was described by Michel Alcubierre in his 1994 paper on warp drive, the creation of a warp drive that would not violate general relativity. And one of the things that he was suggesting was that you would be able to engineer a vector or a pair of vectors in space-time that would, on the one hand, cause a compression of space-time ahead of the vehicle and an expansion of space-time behind the vehicle, and that there would be an intervening space between those two phenomena that would pretty much peg your sense of gravity, your sense of inertia, to the environment that you departed from when you initiated this movement.
So, in essence, what you have is you have a spherical event horizon around this particular region that might be called a dynamically engineered local space-time. And this particular region is set up in such a way that it creates these influences in the surrounding metric in such a way that it also creates a vector that goes in this direction. And so it's kind of like having, it's almost like having a black hole ahead of you and an expansion of space-time behind you. But the actual environmental conditions that you experience inside the spacecraft are pretty much pegged to the time and place that you start out from.
So you don't have any sense of G-forces or being moved around. You don't have any sense of acceleration because the entire pocket of space-time that you're encapsulated in is being accelerated by the vectors that are created around the system. So it's uniformly accelerated. The space-time pocket that you've created, the vehicle itself, the crew, the cargo, everything is moved as one complete package, and so there's no sense of acceleration. But what it allows for, according to Alcubierre's calculations, is what he was calling an arbitrarily large speed, which suggests something in excess of the speed of light at superluminal speeds. So to the person that's inside the vehicle, it may appear that you begin to accelerate away from a particular location, but to the person who's standing outside the disturbed region of space-time, it looks as though you just were gone, just, in an instant.
So this is an ARV, isn't that what it's called?
That's what some people call it. We call it RAM, Replication Alien Machine.
Oh, I see.
Once we retrieved, back in the 30s and 40s and 50s, several of these extraterrestrial vehicles and began to study them, we combined that knowledge with knowledge we already had. Because remember, we had some people like T. Townsend Brown who were studying anti-gravity quite independent of this issue back in the 20s, 30s, and 40s. But when their information got combined with studying these spacecraft, they figured out, this is how they're working.
So they were modeling the universe as being sort of this empty, material-free environment that had this energy that was embedded in it, almost like a fluid in a way, that it had all of this potential that you couldn't see until you found a way of driving it out of this homogeneous sort of state of equilibrium and getting to do usable work.
Now, what is zero-point energy? I'm going to show you many different definitions, but let me quote Nikola Tesla. In 1891, the world's greatest electrical futurist, Nikola Tesla, stated, quote, "Throughout space, there is energy. Is this energy static or kinetic? If static, our hopes are in vain. If kinetic, and we know for certain it is, then it is a mere question of time when men will succeed in attaching their machinery to the very wheelwork of nature. Many generations may pass, but in time our machinery will be driven by a power obtainable at any point in the universe."
And this is very important. It means that we, Homo sapiens, have the ability to access this so-called zero-point field of energy, which is the ambient field of energy from which all matter and energy is fluxing, and can access that energy and generate all the power we need to run this planet without fossil fuels or pollution.
The white background represents the dark energy field. The pulsing represents the electromagnetic distortion around all matter, like two atoms. The electromagnetic distortion pushes dark energy away from matter on a gradient and makes all matter appear to have an attraction towards itself. Gravity can be defined as the electromagnetic force that matter exerts on the universe on dark energy that causes a dark energy field effect, or gravity. You can scale this up from atoms all the way to planets and suns and even black holes. Anything that creates gravity is actually not pulling things into itself like a gravity well. More, it is pushing dark energy away, and in doing so, dark energy is pushing harder on the side with the least distortion. As the fields touch each other, it creates a path of least resistance, and the two objects are forced together by the stronger dark energy field on the side with less distortion, giving matter an attraction towards itself. It's dark energy that causes an attraction of matter towards itself that creates gravity.